She's got everything ready for the evening. The house is immaculate. The nibbles are there. The cigarettes are there. She's all ready for the night. She's ready. Just putting that music on, you know, the I love to love you, baby. And it kind of like generated a sense of excitement in the audience. They knew something was going to happen. That was the music that Beverly on her own would play over and over again, and she'd have a bit of a fantasy, you know, about what she was doing. So that when she's pouring that tonic with that shh kind of business, you know, she would time that to pouring it.
The first time we walked on, the audience just fell about, and I seriously thought my flies were undone. I thought the set behind me had fallen down. We didn't realise how funny we were.
The character is based on somebody I know. She actually came to see it, but she doesn't know it's her.
As far as I was concerned, as the actor, I wouldn't have given him a heart attack, but Mike said he's going to have a heart attack during this party and die.
Abigail's party, as you see it on television as a product, I mean, as a filmmaker, I can't watch it. It's deeply offensive.
Particularly in the theatre when lights go down and I sort of open the door and look around the room, and it was just that thing of, I'm ready. And it was all like, I'm ready to do the play and Beverly's ready for her evening.
Beverly, where are the olives?
In the kitchen, Lawrence. Lawrence, if you want olives, would you put them out, please?
That's lovely. I really like that. Keep it up.
Beverly, where are the olives?
In the kitchen, Lawrence. Lawrence, if you want olives, would you put them out, please?
At this moment, as we speak, there's a very successful production in Sao Paulo in Brazil.
Oh, love to love you, baby.
It's endlessly been performed by all sorts of people. It was very successful in New York.
There is apparently a group of people in Battersea who used to cook, had pilchard curry evenings.
When people find out I was Tony in that play, they go nuts. They still do.
It's a drinking game, isn't it, Abigail's Party? There are people who watch Abigail's Party and drink every time they have a drink, and you're absolutely hammered by the end of it.
People are always quoting it, and they still do.
And you don't mind me mauling your husband, do you?
9 times out of 10, when people stop me and say, oh, you're on the telly, aren't you? Or, oh, we know you, they'll suddenly go, Abigail's Party.
Tony would like a Bacardi and Coke with ice and lemon. Angela would like gin and tonic with ice and lemon. And I'd like a little fill-up. OK.
Fine.
We'd been courting Mike Lee for quite a while. And I seem to recall the way we would court people we wanted to work with would be we'd take them out to lunch to a Chinese down the road on Finchley Road. We spent most of our lunch times in this Chinese restaurant. I ate far too much duck for my health.
I'd been trying to get a gig at Hampstead for ages, and Michael Rudman and David Orkin were running it, and they suddenly, via my agent, got me in to a Chinese restaurant and said, we've got some money, which we've got hold of. We've got a gap, and if you want to do a play, you can have 10 weeks rehearsal, but you've got to say yes now before you leave this restaurant. And I said, I can't do a play, I'm busy, I'm planning this film. And you know, they said, well, you know, you've got to say yes now, you could squeeze it in. And so I sort of, I said, oh, all right.
But of course he wouldn't tell us what he was going to do. And we agreed it would be a 5-cast piece. And that was about all we were allowed to be told at that point.
These sort of ideas, such as I can report, that were going around in my head, which were sort of to do with, you know, materialism, and I'd already been conducting an ongoing investigation into the dreadful suburban experience out of which I came. And all those things are floating around. But added to that was this notion that somehow it would be a play which sort of took the boulevard, anyone for tennis, French windows, people smoking and drinking, convention of a play, and subverted it in some way, so that something horrible would happen.
To absent friends.
To absent friends.
The evolution of Abigail's part is a classic series of accidents and happen chances, and only goes to prove, I think, you know, that often the best art happens in the most casual circumstances.
We went into rehearsal in a place that I regularly rehearsed at, which was a church at Regent's Park, where I had a deal with the vicar, first refusal with the vicar for the space.
As church halls go, it was quite nice, but a bit dusty. I remember turning up on the first day, there was just five actors, and we were all kind of going, hello. I mean, I knew Tim because I'd been at drama school with Tim.
At the time, I had an agent. I said, oh, I'm going to do this thing for Mike Lee at Hampstead. And she said, oh, I live in Hampstead. They won't like that sort of thing.
And it was very exciting, but very daunting, really, to be sitting there and Mike just saying, right, OK, you know, we're going to be making a play together, everyone. And, of course, because we had this date to open, you thought, my God.
Well, we had 10 weeks, which is quite a lot of time to rehearse a play, but not much time for a play that doesn't exist.
He's very uncompromising. That's his part of his talent. I think we had to cancel the first week of previews because he simply wasn't ready.
There's no guarantee that there'll be an end product. There's always the possibility it won't happen because it really is starting from scratch, which is what's so exciting and terrifying about it for him and the actors, I guess. But he did meet that deadline. The play went on in April 1977.
It was a roaring success at Hampstead, and people were, you know, fighting to get tickets.
It was like a rocket going off in the theatre.
We were sold out. People were queuing for tickets. People were, you know, phoning up, begging for tickets. Any chance you could get me a ticket?
I mean, there is no more exciting sound, really, in the theatre than a full house roaring with laughter simultaneously together, sharing it all.
Everybody loved it except Kenneth Williams. I went to one performance and he was there. I was introduced to him. He was dressed all in black with a face as long as a fiddle and left at the interval and hated it.
After the opening, of course, they were queuing up to transfer it to the West End, but there was again another accident on the way.
Alison and I had managed to contrive to cause her to be pregnant at exactly the wrong time, and that rather scuppered the proceedings as far as that went.
Abigail's Party was almost perfect for Play for Today. During my tenure, my ambition was to surprise the audience every week.
Quite fortuitously, Margaret Matheson, of course, came along with her empty studio.
If ever I was a case of somebody being in the right place at the right time, this is it. The fact that Abigail's Party arrived ready-made and just went into a slot at very late notice and was transmitted very soon after that was just great.
It looked like some weird episode of The Good Life with a kind of rather acid undertow to it.
Cheers.
Cheers.
And what are you doing, darling? Are you staying or going?
I'll stay for a while.
Lawrence has to pop out on business, I'm afraid. No, who'd like a cigarette?
We had to lop a bit out because it was too long. The play was about 2 hours and we had to fit it into 90 minutes or whatever the play was, I can't remember, but... and a few copyright issues.
Lawrence. Would you put a record on for us, please?
Yeah, surely. What would we like to hear?
Demis Roussos.
No, Beverly. We don't want to listen to that fat Greek caterwauling all night.
Jose Feliciano got dumped for the Greek gentleman because we couldn't get the rights to that piece of music, but I think that's done his career the world of good, actually. I saw him interviewed on the television, which he said, Abigail's Party revived my career. It's very funny, that, I thought.
Do you think he's sexy, Ange?
Yes. It's a pity he's so fat.
Yeah, but he doesn't sound it, though, does he, when you hear him? No, it's funny. He's still fantastic, though, isn't he?
I swore after Abigail's Party that I would never, ever go into a television studio again, even if it meant I would starve.
I think, not surprisingly, as a filmmaker, Mike was unhappy with the nature of television studio production. Well, he's an artist, so obviously he wanted each frame to be the way he wanted it.
It was done in such a hurry, and it had to be done in a hurry, and everything was, because there are five cameras, everything is compromised to a factor of 20%. You see boom shadows, which is the shadow of the microphone, which is anathema, really, from any filmmaking or indeed television point of view. You see a ridiculous inconsistency of lighting. Somebody is completely in the dark when they should be in the light. And it was all because the whole experience was like driving an articulated, double-articulated truck through a Cotswold village at about 600 miles an hour, you know, without being able to stop and apologise to anybody you've killed on the way. And it was horrible, basically.
The other accident about Abigail's Party was it went out on television very successfully and then was shown again, but not many ripples.
And then the famous thing happened. It went out in August, I think, 1979. There was no Channel 4 yet, so there were only three channels. There was an extremely highbrow programme on BBC Two.
I'm trying now to strike the tone of the shirt.
Mm. And there was an ITV strike. So there were actually two channels. So everybody watched us.
Abigail's Party changed his life in that respect, that it took his work to this vast audience.
I nearly did 3 years as a co-op milkman, you know. Recast at the last minute. Worth about, 25 grand, I think. Lost it. Skin of my teeth.
To be honest, there are times I kind of feel a sense of, oh, I'm not doing anything.
Absolutely. But you objectively know, yes, that that's nonsense.
Yes, yes. But
at the moment, she is only in this situation with this guy.
Mm.
So at the moment, I should hold on to that and trust it.
Well, I mean, working with Mike, I mean, he always says to the actors, you know, to make a list, go home and make a list of people that you know quite well. And then we go through the list, and out of that list, as I was describing various people, Mike eventually picked somebody and said, well, we'll base the character on this person.
And the idea of being an actress is something that wouldn't have occurred to her until possibly even after she'd been at university.
Yes, possibly, yes, yes. And it wouldn't have been a lifelong ambition. She wouldn't have thought, you know, this is what I'm going to do. It would have grown.
Well, it takes shape the way that all Mike's stuff takes shape. You sit down with him and you talk about a lot of people that you know, and he chooses somebody that he's interested in, and then you pursue that, and then you go into their backgrounds and you make up all of their backgrounds. You know everything about them, about which side of the bed they sleep and, you know, who their antecedents are and everything.
This is a man that starts talking to you about what did your character do on its 8th birthday, and, you know, you track right back through. You can tell anybody about that character at any given point.
Diane. Anne. Susan.
When it comes to the naming of the characters, we sit down and we think of all the possible names that she could be called, and we finally arrive at what seems to us to be right, isn't it? And Beverly seemed it. That's right, isn't it?
Mm.
The debate was always whether there would be an E at the end before the Y. There isn't, but that's the one thing that's... it was a bit of... we had to resolve.
there was a woman that I knew in Liverpool who was unusually very glamorous in the sort of suburban world that I lived in. She sort of had an affair with a doctor, and she sort of had red hair, and she was very glamorous, and she was always absolutely, nails were painted, and she had this, you know, way of presenting herself. And I think a lot of Beverly came from that. We sort of decided that a good occupation for Beverly would be a sort of beauty assistant. Her job was working on a makeup counter. And so I went to Selfridges and spent 2 or 3 days just wandering around their makeup department. And I watched one woman in particular who had this tiny little microphone, and she held it like that in the corner of her mouth. Why she had a microphone, I don't know, because there wasn't that many people. But she had an audience of maybe about 50 women and this microphone here. And she asked for a volunteer from the ladies she was going to make up, give her a makeover. She really put herself above everybody. And you really felt, you were quite in awe of this woman, you know, the way she spoke. And I think a lot of the stuff with Beverly and Ange came from that.
Ange, can you take a little bit of criticism?
There was Ange, who didn't really know much about makeup. You know, she only got a little dress on, you know, she didn't know how to do her hair properly. And Beverly sort of saw her as a, right, you know, I can...
Victim.
Victim, I can coach her, I can... Can I give you a little bit of advice about...
Next time, sit down in front of your mirror and just look at yourself and relax and just say, I've got very beautiful lips. Then take your lipstick and apply it. And Ange, you're going to see the difference, because then you will be applying that lipstick to every single corner of your mouth. Do you know what I mean?
I remember during performances, I'd come out into the bar and we'd have a drink. There's a little bar at Hampstead Theatre, and occasionally a man would come over to me and say, whisper to me, oh my God, I know that woman. I've been chased by that woman so many times. You got it absolutely right. And they just disappear.
This is my husband, Tony.
How do you do? Pleased to meet you.
How do you do?
He's got a firm handshake, hasn't he?
Yes.
Yeah, fantastic. Like to come through. Thanks, Tom.
On one level, it's a carefully organised collection of characters on my part that add up to make some kind of sense. But at another level, if I'm honest, it's also quite random. I mean, it so happens that because John Salthouse, who created Tony, had some background as a footballer, we decided to draw on that experience.
So I had been a professional footballer and had an injury and couldn't do what I really wanted to do.
You used to play for Crystal Palace, didn't you?
Yeah.
I was playing a dangerous game, really. I thought I could kind of go into this area, and it did cause me a few problems.
What, you used to play for the reserves, Tom?
Oh, no. It was the first team.
Honestly, is that true?
For a bit, yeah.
The bitterness that's inside Tony when things aren't going well is, you know, it was powered by something that I know all about. You know, to lose that dream when you're that close, it's, you know, some people never recover from it.
The important thing about Tony is not the one detail that he's got a bit of a footballer background, and he's got footballer's legs and all that stuff. Which is only Beverly's notion, by the way. But that it's important for me to have characters who have a whole complexity, as we all do, a whole, you know, collection of all kinds of things that make them the person they are. The important thing about him is that the person he is a, you know, a young, virile, macho sort of guy who finds himself in this rather oppressive domestic situation that, on the whole, could do without.
Have you ever tried pilchard curry?
No.
Oh, that's a very economical dish. You just get one of those big tins of pilchards in tomato sauce and mix it with onions and curry powder, and it's really tasty. But of course, Tony won't touch it.
I came into the restaurant one day and he said to me, your appendix is causing you real problems and you're going to be rushed to hospital. I want you to get changed, put these pyjamas on, get into that hospital bed there. It's in a hospital. And close your eyes, go to sleep and see what happens.
The character was on nights as a nurse and he was a patient. So I think they sort of met with her in that role of being probably quite a good nurse, actually. Because I think people have always wondered why he was remotely attracted to... people have asked me and said, oh, well, and thought he wouldn't be attracted. But I think sometimes in that situation, she was looking at her sort of best, really.
She came up, took my temperature, walked away. This went on for ages and then started talking to me. And eventually we formed a relationship while I was getting better in hospital. The characters fell in love and it was all going brilliantly. And then the dreaded thing of buying a house.
Is it your first house?
Yes. Yeah. We were in a furnished flat before.
Oh, that's a bit grim, isn't it, Ange? Furnished flats, yeah.
Yeah.
This pressure of this mortgage. And then what happened was that she had to work shifts as a nurse. He had to work shifts as a computer programmer. And they started only seeing each other for an hour a day. And sometimes not even that. And then the cracks started in their relationship.
Buying a house is one of the most important decisions you ever make in your life. Don't you agree?
Yes. Isn't it, Tony?
Definitely.
Because it was so worrying with the mortgage and everything.
We had some horrendous rehearsal sessions in terms of not with Mike, but with the things that are going on with the characters. I mean, we had to stop rehearsal once when I started throwing crockery at the wall. I was going absolutely nuts because the characters were just imploding.
Some people say to me, when do you decide when to be funny and when do you decide when to be serious? I don't. It just comes like that. It comes, you know, you mine it from the seam. It comes out ready, comic, tragicomic. You don't have to strive for it. And Abigail's Party is all about that.
Mike one day said to me, would Beverly want to invite the neighbours in for a drink? And I said, oh, yes, she'd love to. She'd absolutely adore that. And he said, well, who would she invite? And I said, she'd certainly invite Tony and Angela. He said, why is that? I said, well, she wants to show off her home to them. And she quite fancies, she's seen this guy, Tony, and she quite, you know, through the neck curtain, she quite fancies him. And she felt sorry for Sue, because Sue's on her own.
All right, Sue.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. Come through.
And so what better thing to do than to have a drinks party?
He said, there's a lady across the road who invited you. And we went to the door of the rehearsal room. We had all our costume on and everything.
There was a sort of knock at the church hall door.
Both Janine and I just went, we just couldn't believe what Alison had done, you know.
I was completely shocked because this character was absolutely nothing like Alison Steadman.
I couldn't believe it was the same woman that I met the weeks before. You know, she's a great actress.
Beverly in Abigail's Party, well, she's sort of one of the great modern comic creations. I think Alan Bennett, who, when he chose the piece as his ideal night in on television, said that she had the shoulders of a truck driver and the walk to match. There's something absolutely horrendous about her.
This is it, though, isn't it? With fitty carpets, you don't know what to do for the best. Now, particularly with teenagers, because let's face it, they're not as careful as, say, we would be. Do you know what I mean? They don't think, do they? They've got a drink in one hand and a cigarette in the other, you know, and they're having a bit of a dance, and the next thing you know, it's cigarette on your carpet and stubbed out.
She's a wonderful creation. She's right up there with the great comic creations of modern drama. It was one of those career-defining performances for Alison Steadman.
Well, the thing about Alison Steadman is that she's endlessly versatile.
Keith?
Hmm?
No, you always tell me to do everything 72 times.
Hmm?
Well, I don't think that can be right, because, for instance, you're chewing nuts now. And they have to be chewed 72 times because they're very hard. But earlier on, I was eating mushroom, and I only got as far as 31, and it slipped down my throat quite naturally. So it doesn't always have to be 72 times, does it?
Candice Marie is non-smoking, non-drinking, vegetarian, really tedious, kind of boring woman. Almost innocent, sort of childlike kind of person.
I want to take you there, he said, I want to go with you.
And I loved playing her. I mean, I loved all the woolly hats. I loved the walking boots and all that and putting up our tent and everything. There's a lot of me in that that enjoys that sort of thing.
It's a lovely key.
Yes.
So it was great then to be able to play Beverly, who's right at the other end of the spectrum, who, you know, her whole life is to do with makeup, glamour, clothes, breasts, you know. Candace Marie sort of, you know, played down her bosoms, you know. Beverly showed them off.
And imagine making love to this, do you know what I mean?
Those two pieces of work, Abigail's Party and Nuts in May, simply demonstrate the enormous range of her skills.
Now then, Sue, let's see. A little cheesy pineapple one, sir. A little cheesy pineapple one.
For me, the characters and the objects and the sense of place and time and the atmosphere and the light and all of those things that give you a sense of the real world is part of the celebration of life that it's all about. So, in Abigail's Party, plainly, the material things are of the stuff of what the play is.
I would have worked immediately from trying to analyse Beverly's character to imagine the kind of items which would she would feel were right for her house.
The great thing was that we could say, well, how about this? Or I think she appeared with certain things and you go, brilliant, that's great. Definitely have one of those. I'm not so sure about that. So it was that sort of thing. So it was a two-way thing. During the rehearsals, the Ideal Home exhibition was on, and of course that would be a place that Beverly would definitely want to go to. So he said, how about if the two of you go along in character, which we did.
Lawrence and Beverly were just looking at things generally, what they thought would have suited their home. All of these things just give you a bit more depth to playing the character.
We were sorting out their tastes, their likes, their dislikes, what Beverly would want, what she would, you know, and Lawrence was always saying, no, Beverly, you know, we don't want lilac or we don't want purple or whatever, you know.
If Beverly had had her way, it would have been very garish. I think Lawrence felt that he had a bit more taste, which I think he did, not a lot, but he had a bit more taste than Beverly.
It was really good. We were around all the show houses and I think that's probably where she got the rotisserie idea from.
Oh, and you've got one of these.
What's that, Ange? Oh, the rotisserie.
Yeah.
Do you do chickens and things on it?
Well, you can do. To be honest, I'm not much of a cook, so I haven't actually used it yet, but you can.
Beverly's not a cook. Well, she couldn't break her nails, could she? On, she wouldn't peel a potato.
This is our downstairs toilet. Okay.
Tom.
She's come from a background where she hasn't had very much. She grew up on a council estate. She hasn't got leather look. She's got real leather. She wouldn't have leather look.
This is the suite I was telling you about. It's nice, isn't it?
Lovely.
A magazine is chosen and it's placed. Everything is chosen. The onyx table, very proud of that. Again, not fake, real.
And this is what I'd really love.
What's that, Ange? Oh, the candelabra. Yeah, it's brilliant, isn't it?
Is it real silver?
Yeah, silver plate, yeah.
One of the things that's most enjoyable about the play is the detail. The rotisserie, the candelabra, the leather sofas, all this kind of stuff, it's all social calibration. You know, Beverly is absolutely somebody who likes to make her place in the world by what she owns.
I'd like to introduce you to a new kind of hostess. The Echo Hostess. I'm always having people in for a meal, but they often turn up late. So when I cook the food, I just pop it into here.
Filling your house with lovely possessions is another way of telling everyone that you've achieved the dream, which is what's really, really important to Beverly and to Lawrence.
Would you drink instant coffee if you could make fresh ground coffee instantly? Now prepare fresh ground coffee instantly with Prescalator by Ronco.
For me, the play's a satire about consumerism. I mean, Thatcher's still 2 years away when we made the film. So it's the Jim Callaghan industrial chaos period.
The thing about 1977 was that you had the Silver Jubilee, that was the Queen, the emergence of the Sex Pistols.
Your daughter?
15.
What does she look like? Because I might have seen her.
Oh, well, she's quite tall and she's got fair hair, quite long fair hair.
She hasn't got a pink streak in her hair, has she?
Yes.
They tapped into something which was increasingly happening, which was the emergence of punk had a kind of wildness in youth.
And she wears those jeans, you know, with the patches on, and safety pins going right down the side and the scruffy bottom.
And plumber's overalls.
Oh, yeah, plumber's overalls. She makes me die, you know.
So it sounds to me that she's at the weird point, which is 1977, an interesting point in British pop music, is that between a hippie and a punk, she's just flipping around.
She's absolutely not what any of the people in the house understand.
You've got a revolution that's happening outside that you can only just hear, and it's new, and it sounds a bit odd and a bit, maybe a bit scary, and it's coming up and it's actually going to blow that all away.
What was happening then was that the Tories were building, you know, towards the 79 election victory. William Hague gave his speech at the conference in 77.
It's all right for some of you. Half of you won't be here in 30 or 40 years' time.
So you can, in a sense, what were known as Thatcherite values hover.
The German word is Zeitgeist. It seemed to kind of really hit on a nerve with people. And I suppose it's that house thing, because it's still going crazy now, and it seems to strike a chord with everybody, you know, that thing of you must own your house, you know, you must do this and kill yourself, but you must do this.
Come on.
Lawrence, you're gonna get heartburn.
Miss O'Halligan, Mr. Moss here, Wibbly Webb. Now, where's that key to 15 Clittingham Avenue?
Lawrence works himself to death. That's what happens in that play. He works so, so hard that he works himself to death. And what is he doing? He's selling houses. It's all about houses, and it's incredibly prescient because of that.
There's a very interesting sort of background in Abigail's Party, which I think comes through the play, which is about people moving into new streets. There's a line, but of course our houses are bigger than your houses on that side of the road.
I expect you've seen a few changes since you've been here, eh, Sue?
Not really, no.
Come, Sue, surely you must have seen some changes.
And there's this conversation that happens between Sue and Lawrence, the estate agent, about how the neighbourhoods change. And it's incredibly euphemistic.
It's more mixed, that's all.
Mixed? Yes, I suppose you could say it was mixed.
Clearly, they mean black people have arrived. But there's no, you know, there's a kind of, there's a real nervousness about talking about it, which is quite good in one sense. I mean, there's a politeness about it, but underneath, you can feel the tensions.
More cosmopolitan.
Well, there's nothing wrong with that.
Oh, you don't think there's anything wrong with that?
No, I don't.
No, well, that's a matter of opinion.
I grew up in the 50s in a deeply provincial, suburban, repressive, boring, respectable, squeaky clean world. I suppose in some ways Abigail's Party has become, in the grander scheme of things, the kind of mother of all Mike Lee statements about that world.
While the actors were rehearsing, improvising the play in London, I had that same period to come and research the kind of location that we wanted. And Mike had briefed me that it should be a suburban location on the central line into central London, where Beverly worked in Selfridges at the cosmetics counter. This is one of the houses I came to see because I got in touch with the local estate agents and I have one remaining prospectus, I suppose you'd call it, of one of the houses I went into. So it's fascinating to see it again now. I'm trying to put my mind back into how I would have sensed this house 30 years ago. And I think it would have been a very new build at that time. So that in itself would have appealed to Beverly, that it was fresh and new and not somebody else's house. So I suspect they were probably the first or at least the second owners. It's got a lovely little front door set back behind its own little porch, and that would have appealed, with a garage and off-street parking. So it feels very right.
You must be a friend. I'm coming.
Thank you.
Where do you come from?
Thank you.
Okay. I'd really love to just have a look around and see how the space is well fit in my memory, really. So you can come through here because I do remember the sitting room and I remember this space as being the dining space, as you obviously still have. And possibly a door through there?
There was a door.
There was a door.
Originally there was.
Because that was very important to me, that everything was sort of in layers, that the kitchen was beside the dining room, was beside the sitting room, so that in a play, everybody can talk to one another through the space. I just wanted to ask you about this cabinet. Was this something you inherited or bought for this house?
I bought for the house.
Bought for the house. Because that's interesting, because I remember she had something similar. And is this a desk or a cupboard that comes down like that?
It comes
that?
Down.
Can I,
yeah, of course you can.
Got something secret inside.
No, drink.
Drink, oh, that's good. That's what I want to
it's
see.
It's been there for
how
years.
How do I do it? Just pull? Pull it. That's exactly
obviously
right.
It's so old.
Now, I'm amazed that you say you bought this, because I would have thought that this had been here. So, interestingly, she had something very similar.
Oh, it's nothing very special, I'm afraid.
Oh, isn't that kind, Ange?
Yeah.
Not at all.
Oh, lovely, because Lawrence likes a drop of wine, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. It's Beaujolais. Lovely. Oh, won't be a sec. I'll just pop it in the fridge, OK?
A criticism that has been levelled at Mike Lee, I think entirely unfairly, is that he's a snob and that what we're being encouraged to do is to laugh at working-class people who don't know the rules.
There was a fuss made, including a correspondence in The Times at the time, about Beaujolais, because it turned out that people who really knew and know do put Beaujolais in the fridge. But the fact is that it always got a huge laugh because most people thought and think that you don't put red wine in the fridge and assumed, as most people did and do, that that includes Beaujolais. It turns out that that isn't the case with Beaujolais, but we didn't know that because we're just ordinary suburban folk.
You know, there was things like, I'll get the Beaujolais, you know, put the Beaujolais in the fridge and all that, but that's what was happening then. People were being encouraged to climb the social ladder, own your own house, do this, do that, you know, and unfortunately, people were not educated in the ways of wine or whatever, you know, but they were encouraged to, you know, rise up and grab the next set of values up the scale, you know, do that. That was going on then.
Dennis Potter, the great television playwright, was writing a column in the Sunday Times and berated Mike Lee for patronising his characters. I don't know why he felt so antipathetical towards Abigail's Party, but anyway, he did. It was a great tirade against the doing down of innocent working class people.
I think because maybe their characteristics are heightened a little, then people think that that's why you're meant to point and laugh, but actually they're just heightened a little because it was a play, that's all. I have a lot of sympathy for those characters.
It's a play, Abigail's Party, that works on a whole lot of different levels. It's not simply a naturalistic, you know, totally real experience. It should become a heightened real experience when you watch it. But at the same time, you know, you're being asked to laugh at jokes, to laugh with them, to laugh at us, to laugh at yourself through laughing at them, to reflect on the nature of the irony and contradiction of how things are, to think about a lot of stuff that's to do with life and how we live it.
Now, who's for another drink? Come on, Ange. Sue, another drink?
No, thank you.
No, come on, Sue. I'll just give you a little top-up.
That's it, lovely.
Just to settle your nerves, Sue.
I think Susan does feel very much an outsider. I think she doesn't know, she hasn't learnt, for some reason or other, she hasn't learnt how to let herself be included.
in a way, Susan, Sue, is the character who is watching this event with us, in a certain sense, except that she has both more than everybody else. She's got kids, she's, you know, more fulfilled in one sense, but at the same time, she's the loneliest of the characters in surface terms. But in fact, they're all lonely.
Your husband's away then, is he?
No, we've split up, actually.
Are you separated or divorced?
Divorced.
Oh, when did you get divorced?
3 years ago.
Oh, well, that's given you time to sort of get used to it, hasn't it?
She's not the kind of person that Beverly would choose to live next to, and certainly not, Beverly isn't the kind of person she would choose to live next to. And there's an element of wariness and guardedness, and they are, it's a sort of diluted form of class warfare.
Susan represented to Lawrence, I think, something that he would like to aim for. She had a class, she had dignity, and she had intelligence, and these were all things that Lawrence valued very highly, and which the other people at this particular party certainly didn't have.
I think that musicians and artists are very lucky people. They're born with one great advantage in life. Do you know what that is? Their talent. Yeah.
She could have made an effort with Lawrence. She could have made his life so much easier that evening, and she didn't. She just didn't really want to, I suppose, lower herself, really.
Darling, why don't you dance with Sue?
I really don't think Sue wants to dance, thanks very much, darling.
Then why don't you ask her, Lawrence?
I think she would almost rather have died than get up there. But then, of course, in that situation, especially with somebody like Beverly egging you on,
now, go on, Sue. Have a little dance with Lawrence. Go on, enjoy yourself. Have a little dance. Go on.
Would you like to, Sue?
All right.
I'll take the glass for you.
Okay.
There's nothing else she could have done but get up there and just be crucified with embarrassment.
Lawrence is my height, short ass, and Susan is a very tall lady. So I think that put extra pressure on him.
Do you know Paris?
A little.
I think he made the best of it. Best of a bad deal.
Thank you.
All she expected was to sit down at a dinner table and talk politely over food. But none of that happened.
Ah! Oh, my God, I jumped against that!
Don't tempt me!
Well, come on, then, do it!
Abigail's party is undoubtedly the battle of the sexes. Another great influence on me is the great American humorist and cartoonist James Thurber. In fact, the battle of the sexes is one of his titles. There are all those wonderful cartoons of dominating women and little Lawrence-type characters quaking in their boots and all kinds of relationship stuff going on. I mean, you could call the play The Tyranny of Women, possibly, but at the same time, you know, we're all culpable and we're all victims, and these men and women are victims of social expectations and what society makes them be.
Lawrence, would you please go back in the kitchen and finish making your little sandwich? All right.
You've got three relationships there. You've got a relationship that's not going very well. You've got a relationship that really is at the end of its tether, which is Beverly and Lawrence's. And you've got a relationship that's broken down. So there are three stages of rotten marriages.
I mean, they're not happy marriages. They're very, very tense. And there are moments when that surfaces. And there are moments when, for instance, Beverly is flirting with Tony that are just not pleasant to be around.
What would you like?
Light out, please.
Do you want a little Bacardi to go with it?
No, thank you.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Are you all right?
Yeah.
Great.
From Tony's point of view, he feels that that's, you know, he needs to go with someone like that rather than a timid little nurse now. That's what he wants. He doesn't really run a mile, but he's had a few drinks and he thinks, you know, bugger it, you know, I'm in for a penny, in for a poundie.
But it's just fun for the night. Why not? She's had a few drinks. he's kind of, you know, she likes the idea he's been a footballer. As soon as she hears he's been a footballer, and she looks and she says, oh, he's got footballer's legs, you know, she's suddenly undressing him and she just stops. She's a very physical, very, you know, sexy kind of woman.
Oh, yes, oh, yes. I like footballer's legs, actually. Nice and muscly, aren't they?
She does sort of see it, but thinks, you know, he's very attractive. She thinks her husband's very attractive, and he's her husband. You know, it's quite nice that other people find him attractive in a way. I think there's a sort of naivety about her.
You don't mind me mauling your husband, do you, Ange?
No, you go ahead.
And as soon as she twigs that Ange isn't jealous and Ange isn't, Ange is just accepting that it's all right, you go ahead, you know, she thinks, brilliant, you know, I will.
I don't think she was a very nice person. But Lawrence loved her. He loved her. He saw her faults. But I think because she was such an attractive, sort of almost like a trophy wife, so it was worth putting up with all of that nonsense.
Go on, dance with Lawrence. Of course you can. Get up and dance.
There's something really scary about Tony. He is just so angry, so frustrated with everything to do with his life. It's, I mean, he murders Ange every time he looks at her. Every time he looks at her, he is putting a knife in her heart.
I just learnt this one tune from a friend. It was, buy a broom, buy a broom.
I think he does have a sort of temper. Tony, and she could sense, you know, him getting irritated with her, but that just sometimes makes it worse if you're irritating your partner. It makes you more sort of anxious, really.
Yeah, there's frustration, terrible frustration, and there was a moment that sort of grew on stage where at one point she just wouldn't shut up towards the end, and Tony could feel that things were getting out of hand with Beverly and Lawrence because they started having a full-blown argument.
Oh, shut up, Lawrence!
Now, don't you tell me to shut up!
Angela, coat.
No, it's all right.
I really think I ought to be going.
When he finally explodes at Ange, you knew it was coming.
You just can't keep your big mouth shut, can you? Get up! We've all been round people's houses where people are having an argument in front of us, and you just think, I can't believe these two people are together. Actually, they really are. Because that's the person they're permitted to say those things to, you know.
Well, the party certainly seems to be hotting up at your place, Sue.
Yes, so Beverly said.
Yes, actually, Lawrence, we were just saying it might be a good idea if a little bit later on, if you and Tony pop down there.
There have been so many things written about what happened at the party and, you know, that will always remain a mystery. It's a bit like a Harold Pinter pause. They say to him, what happened in that pause? He says, you decide.
Your shirt's all wet.
Why is it?
Nothing.
It's soaking wet.
What have you been doing?
Nothing. Get off. Just bumped into somebody accidentally. It's a minor incident, nothing to worry about. Mike wants to tell you what happened down there. He knows. If he wants to tell you, fine. I'm not going to break the myth of Abigail's party.
And if you're going to ask me, or if anybody's going to ask me, what happens to Tony down there, then, well, that's for you to decide. There's a 1908 cartoon film, a French cartoon film, which is all done with stick figures called Drama Amongst Puppets. It's very simple and short. I mean, it's like characters drawn on a blackboard moving. It's one of those pieces that's almost a point of reference for me. And in a way, the stage with this, you know, living room and a drama amongst puppets going on, and plonk, the guy dies. You know, it's a kind of, that's a sort of conceptual thing that, you know, makes me stand back and distill the whole thing.
We'd done, you know, weeks of improvisations and things, and I remember this particular improvisation was where Beverly and Lawrence have a row about this painting that she's been made to put in the bedroom.
Can I see it?
Do you want to see it, Ange?
Yeah.
And of course, Angie's saying, oh, I'd love to see it. So off I went in the improvisation.
I saw Lawrence starting to have what looked like a heart attack. And I'm afraid, as an actress, I just thought, oh, shit.
And I remember Janine, who was supposed to be a trained nurse, didn't know what to do. I think she'd go, it was just too much for her.
As a terrible sort of worried, lazy actress, I just slunk into my chair and thought, but I'll pretend I haven't seen it.
And I'm coming back on stage, or, you know, in my head, into the living room, and there was Lawrence on the floor, sort of going, you know, doing all this, and I was so shocked.
I still just didn't move. I just thought, and from the back of the stalls, I remember Mike going, get up! And I just thought, So I did. I got up and sort of fussed around in a rather inept fashion. And that was then the impro ended. And then after that, we looked into exactly what she would have done if she'd known her job a bit better.
The experience of dying actually got to me very badly.
No, you're all right.
I remember when Mike said, OK, come out of character, that Tim just started to cry.
I've taken it too far in on myself, and I actually really, really imagined me. I don't know whether I was still in character then. I don't think I was. I think I was then Tim Stern actually dying and thinking about everything I was missing. And I remember I ran off and locked myself in the lavatory.
Get me something for his head. Get his feet up higher.
Hey-o.
No, that's too big.
Hey-o.
What's going on? What's the matter with him? Lawrence. What's happened, Angel? He passed out.
My favourite moment in the play is when the heart attack happened. Tony spends the whole evening giving the impression that there's this voluptuous woman across the road that he's going to seduce, and, you know, they're going to go off to Palma Nova and drink sangria and have a wonderful time, and suddenly reality bites, and the person who you think least would be able to cope in that room is the person who's qualified, who's a nurse, and actually suddenly goes bang and is absolutely brilliant, and he just falls in line and needs her so much at that point and defends her and pushes Beverly away and does everything he's told.
Lawrence, come on. Leave him! Actually, Angela, he happens to be my husband.
Yeah, right. You've got to let him breathe.
Yeah, well, he is breathing, for Christ's sake.
Can you get you in an ambulance?
No, Lawrence, come on.
Ambulance?
Yes.
It's quite nice that you do see that side of her, with the relationship with Tony, that, you know, he's sort of got respect for her at the end doing that rather than for Beverly, who he's been flirting with all night. Really.
And you suddenly see them come together, and you get a glimmer of what you might have seen them if you'd have seen them 5 years earlier when they actually were getting on fine.
And his face is going
on. Oh, yes.
Someone turn that bleeding record off! What?
I can't hear Beethoven's Fifth now without hearing Lawrence, and all that stuff going on, heavy breathing and all of that. I mean, it's ruined the whole experience, unfortunately.
The National Theatre did 100 best plays, and they do these platforms with the plays, so they do a sort of early evening kind of show. And Mike Lee asked me to do this. It was the Olivier, I think. It's a huge theatre. Original cast.
It was quite shocking because Harriet had died, who played Susan on the television.
This young assistant director came running in, who had organised this platform performance, and his face was white, and he said, the Olivier Theatre is sold out for a platform performance for the first time in its history, and there are people fighting at the box office to get in. He said, it's only been on the internal mailing list for the National Theatre. Oh, my God, and went out again.
Can you please welcome our guest for the Play of the Century, Abigail's Party.
And when we came on to do this gig, it was like a Stones concert. It was extraordinary. I mean, I have to say, I've never had any experience like it ever.
We played Love to Love You Baby as we walked on. And the five of us walked on with Mike, and the whole place was cheering. It was kind of like we were going, ooh.
And it was a bit like being a pop star. It was sort of ridiculous.
And it was amazing. We went on and, you know, people were standing and cheering.
And they all just stood up as one and cheered for about 10 minutes until we sort of sat down just on five chairs and read the first, whatever it was, the first extract.
Would you mind if I asked you a personal question?
And as she becomes Beverly, she does that thing where her shoulders very slightly rise and the entire audience clapped. Except these two Americans at the front who clearly got caught in the wrong show. I had no idea what they were at, and they all went...
Because then you will be applying your lipstick to every single corner of your mouth. Do you know what I mean?
The play is very popular amongst gay men, particularly in South London, and there were sort of posses of you know, men with short hair and clipped moustaches, all chanting the words at the same time as they were doing them on stage. It was a very strange experience. It was great fun.
Thank you. Thank you.
Having been there at that beginning when we were in that church hall with no reason to suppose this would have any life other than 6 weeks at Hampstead, I found it very moving, really. And I've just felt quite proud of it.
If it has endured and it is popular, it's because it is about us, and so many people see themselves in it. I think the kind of awfulness and sadness and madness and vulgarity and aspirations and all those things that it's about, I mean, we just do... people do resonate with them and see themselves or their neighbours.
First started drinking this when I went to Mallorca.
Oh, have you been to Mallorca, Tom?
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Where'd you go?
Palma.
Not Palma Nova.
That's right, yeah.
Oh, Tony, isn't it beautiful there?
Yeah.
Yes. They drink it very long there, don't they? With lots of ice and coke and lemon and that, yeah? It's my dream, actually, just to lie on a beach sipping Bacardi and coke.
Oh, what, where would Beverly be now? What a fun thought.
She'd probably remarry. Maybe a nice, rich husband.
I would think that she's going to have had children because, in a sense, what else is she going to do?
She would have a job, whether it was tele presenting or whether it was applying makeup. She would have a job.
Probably on the streets, a hooker, high-class hooker.
She's probably in Spain running a bar or something.
Beverly, probably on a third or fourth husband. No children. I don't know what she's doing. She's probably still painting her nails somewhere.